All right. Thank you, Professor Wiebe. Ladies and gentlemen, at the beginning of my presentation, I will speak shortly about the possible forms of legal protection of research data and the corresponding scope of protection. And subsequently, my colleague Thomas Magoni is going to speak about some licensing issues in context of OpenAI Plus. So a common guess is that copyright is the most important IP right in the area of research data. However, in the context of OpenAI Plus, this is not true, since OpenAI mainly focuses on the use of scientific databases. Generally, the main requirement for obtaining copyright protection is the intellectual creation of an author. In the EU, databases can be protected by copyright when they represent the intellectual creation of their maker by reason of the selection or arrangement of the content. Furthermore, databases can be protected by another right, the database right, which is also often called sui generis right. In contrast to copyright protection, no intellectual creation is required to enjoy sui generis protection. But the database has to be systematically or methodically arranged. The elements of the database have to be individually accessible, and the database has to have required a substantial investment, whereby the first two requirements are merely of a technical character. The most important requirement is the substantial investment. The copyright and the database right seem to be quite similar. Indeed, this is true at some points, but they are very different in many details. Therefore, it's very important to evaluate which right is applicable, especially because the scope of protection is different. For example, the duration of the database right is much shorter than copyright. Within OpenAI Plus, data from different sources will be linked to create new kinds of complex publications, so-called enhanced publications. In particular, peer-reviewed literature and associated data sets and collections will be linked to each other. The data which are used within the project are regularly stored in large scientific databases. And this raises the question whether these databases are protected by copyright and/or the sui generis right. As scientific databases are intended to be as complete as possible, and the arrangement of data is usually standard scientific practice, scientific databases will regularly fail to meet the requirement of an intellectual creation and thereby be very rarely protected by copyright. On the other hand, the most databases which match the technical criteria do require a minimum of investment and are protectable by the sui generis right. Therefore, the criteria for database protection are regularly met by scientific databases. In the following, I will speak about the scope of protection and thereby focus on the database right as the most important IP right for the e-infrastructure of OpenAI Plus. The database right gives the owner of the right two exclusive rights. These are the right of extraction and the right of reutilization of the whole or of a substantial part of the contents of a database. Extraction thereby means the transfer of the contents of a database to another medium. This means nothing else than copying. And reutilization means any form of making available to the public. To commit an infringement, a qualitatively or quantitatively substantial part of the database has to be used. Whether a part is substantial or not is decided on a case-by-case basis. In quantitative terms, for example, the Federal Supreme Court of Germany has held the extraction of 75% of the data to be a substantial part, and the extraction of only 10% not to be substantial. But this is just an example. And according to the ECJ, the European Court of Justice, a quantitatively negligible part of the contents of a database may in fact represent, in terms of obtaining, verification, or presentation, significant human, technical, or financial investment, and thereby be substantial. Article 9 of the Database Directive contains a limited number of exceptions to the sui generis right the member states can provide for. In our context, the exception for scientific research may be of interest. However, it is important to note that the exceptions mentioned in Article 9 are not mandatory, which means that the regulations in the different member states are not fully harmonized. In Germany, for example, Article 87c of the Copyright Act states that the copying of a substantial part of a database is possible for one's own private or scientific use. Here it has to be noted that just the copying of the data is possible and not reutilization. Hence, making a substantial part of a database available to the public, even for scientific use, is not permitted. Another example from the UK, according to Regulation 20, Database Regulations 1997, the database right in a database which has been made available to the public is not infringed by fair dealing with a substantial part of its contents if that part is extracted from the database for the purposes of illustrating, for teaching, or research. This exception only allows extraction and not reutilization of substantial parts too. So as we can see from these examples, the scientific research exception is rather limited, and making available to the public does regularly not fall within the scope. In the legal study, we further analyze the extent to which the scope of protection covers the most relevant types of usage of research data as envisaged within OpenAI Plus. I would like to give two examples of use types. So, one example is linking. The e-infrastructure of OpenAI Plus involves cross-linking of a very broad spectrum of scientific publications and selected subset of related data sets, in particular peer-reviewed literature and associated data sets and collections will be linked to create the mentioned enhanced publications. So let me give an a simple example of linking of data. So this is the OpenAI demonstrator. Maybe I can use this. And on this page, there are information about a publication which is contained in OpenAI Plus. And if you go on the publication link, which is here, you're redirected to another site, which is the site of the data repository. So in this case, it is Tilburg University repository. And this page is no longer the open air page, but the page of the university repository. And on this page, there are again information about the publication. And with another click, you can access a full text article, since this one is an open access one. So this kind of linking is one of the main features of OpenAI Plus. From a technical point of view, it's very important to note that a simple hyperlink in an information network, such as the internet, does not constitute a new physical fixation, but merely an electronic referral to an already existing copy of the work. Consequently, from a legal point of view, the linking to information is not a reproduction and thus no relevant transfer of data. According to the reutilization right, which means again making available to the public, one must note that the linked copy of the work is already accessible on the internet before the linking. So we don't need the site of OpenAIR to access the site of the repository. It's possible to access the repository directly. So some national courts have decided that a hyperlink to the contents of an external freely available website does not infringe on the publicly making available right of the right holder. However, the right shall be infringed when the hyperlink leads to the circumvention of technical protection measures the right holder has taken to prevent uncontrolled access. Accordingly, the linking to information which is freely accessible in the internet should be possible. Just in case that the direct access of information which shall be linked is restricted by the right holder, his consent is required. Okay, another activity I would like to show and which is highly relevant for OpenAIR Plus is data mining. In OpenAIR Plus will experiment with the interlinking of publications and data sets across different disciplines. It will apply sophisticated algorithms to automatically infer semantic relationships between different entities of research results. To this aim, text mining will be applied on bibliographic metadata, full text resources, to extract references to funding information, data sets, bibliographic references, and so on. So let me show you this second example. This is again the OpenAIR demonstrator, which contains information about a publication which is contained in OpenAIR Plus. And if you use this link, search this publication in your library, you are again redirected to another site. Need some time. And on the page, which is hopefully coming soon, you can find information. You can find. Okay. This is new. I've never seen this page before. Whatever. You're redirected to a site where you can find institutions where this article is contained, or you can access this article. For example, Cambridge University Press, or some electronic libraries. So, okay. Whatever. The information which are contained in the external database, for example, of the site of the Cambridge University Press or the EZB, it's a page in Germany, there are information contained about an article. So the question is, if we use this information which are contained in the external database, does this infringe on the sui generis right? To remind you, the sui generis right is infringed as far as the underlying database is protected by the sui generis right, and a substantial part of it is either transferred to another medium or made available to the public. In our case, the other databases are not made available to the public, but just linked, as already mentioned before. And according to the right of reproduction, no general statement can be given. Whether this right is infringed in the case of data mining or not depends on what technical actions are carried out by the text mining tools. So if protected data is copied in a material form, for example, in the permanent or even the working memory of a computer, the database right could be infringed. Unfortunately, I have to stop here, but the good news is that our presentations are not over, so thank you very much.